racism on display tonight by a rookie police officer in San Jose. Officer Pedro Garcia rushing to rescue a driver trapped inside a burning car. Police posting this video today saying, in this job, seconds count, and combined with bravery, can save lives. Tonight, is the COVID surge slowing down? The new forecast as we head into the fall, but also new questions over how soon kids 5 to 11 can get vaccinated. Pfizer's chief insisting that decision is in the hands of the FDA. The White House says more than 400,000 Americans received booster shots over the weekend. And the new study about possible side effects after that third shot. Facing the heat on Capitol Hill today, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Mark Milley, defending his calls to China at the end of President Trump's term and making a big admission. He, along with other top Pentagon leaders, advised against withdrawing all troops from Afghanistan ahead of that chaotic evacuation. Milley calling the 20-year Afghan war a strategic failure, saying the enemy is in charge. So what comes next? Tonight, the high-stakes negotiations at the White House and Capitol Hill. Democrats under immense pressure to pass both infrastructure bills or risk both failing. We're joined by a progressive Democrat in the House. Will they be voting for the Senate bill? And tonight, a potential government shutdown also looming. Rachel Scott is on Capitol Hill for us. Tonight, all eyes on a Los Angeles courthouse, a major moment for the Free Britney movement. Nearly every aspect of Britney Spears' life has been controlled for 13 years, and it could all end tomorrow. Our in-depth report. And tonight, America Strong, finding a path forward through music. The teacher helping an Afghan American adjust to his family's new reality safe in the U.S., as so many they know remain in Afghanistan under Taliban control.
When I play music, I focus a lot to not to mess up. Like, I forget everything else, and that kind of helps me in a way.
I miss my home, Afghanistan.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Phil Lipoff in for Lindsay Davis. Thank you so much for streaming with us tonight. We begin tonight with a bit of positive news in this seemingly unrelenting pandemic. A new forecast used by the CDC is predicting cases will continue to drop this fall. Deaths will go down and hospitalizations could be cut nearly in half in just the next 2 weeks. In New York State, where a vaccine mandate for hospital and nursing home staff took effect at midnight, vaccinations are actually surging. Still, some are taking to the streets to protest the vaccine mandate. But while adults are getting vaccinated, hundreds of children are still being hospitalized each day. And with school fully underway right now, more questions tonight over when the FDA will be able to authorize Pfizer's vaccine for children 5 to 11. Pfizer announcing it has submitted its data to the FDA. So, how soon could those shots be going into arms? Eva Pilgrim leads us off tonight.
You ready? She's going to count for me, okay?
Tonight, Pfizer says it has started submitting trial data to the FDA showing the vaccine is safe and effective in 5 to 11-year-olds. The FDA beginning its review right away.
In the next few weeks, they will examine that data and hopefully they'll give the okay so that we can start vaccinating children, hopefully before the end of October.
Officials warning that timeline could slide by a few weeks. The number of Americans hospitalized with COVID down more than 20% since early September, but hundreds of kids are still going into hospitals every day. At Dayton Children's Hospital, a vaccine for the young can't come soon enough.
This year, it just seems like they're just so much sicker. Can't breathe, having a really hard time breathing. I'm worried and anxious for them.
Across the country, new vaccination lines for Pfizer boosters. More than 400,000 Americans have rolled up their sleeves since the weekend, and almost a million more have scheduled shots for the coming weeks.
If you know that you can do something to help you stay well, then why not do it?
A new CDC study finding the side effects from booster shots were similar to those after the second dose. The most common were fatigue, headache, and sore arm that went away within a few days. Across the country, a showdown over vaccine mandates. In North Carolina, Novant Health firing 175 workers for refusing to get the vaccine. And in New York, a midnight deadline pushing thousands of healthcare workers across the state to get their first shot or risk being fired or suspended. 92% of hospital staff now have at least one vaccine shot.
Every single time the city of New York wins because we have a simple, simple argument. We're protecting the health and well-being of our employees, of our kids.
My body, my choice.
10% of New York City teachers who are still unvaccinated now facing a Friday deadline to get that first shot. In North Carolina, teacher and mother of four Meredith Mongone, who was unvaccinated, got COVID in August. Before dying last week, she urged her daughters to get the shot.
Well, she made the appointment to get her oldest vaccinated, and they will all get vaccinated as soon as they can. The vaccine does work. She probably would be here.
Eva Pilgrim joins us now. And Eva, we know millions of Americans who got the Moderna and Johnson & Johnson vaccines are waiting to learn whether they'll need boosters. Also, Dr. Fauci saying today we may know soon whether it's safe and effective to boost with a different vaccine.
That's right, Phil. The NIH has been studying mixing and matching vaccines. Dr. Fauci said that the data on Moderna as a booster is actually already in. The data on J&J as a booster is expected within the next week. So we should have some answers to those questions very soon. Phil.
Eva, thank you. Now to the grilling on Capitol Hill today. America's top military brass pressed on the chaotic and deadly withdrawal from Afghanistan and appearing to contradict President Biden when they revealed that their advice was to leave some U.S. troops behind in Afghanistan. Here's ABC's chief global affairs correspondent Martha Raddatz.
Good morning.
It was an extraordinary moment. For the first time, the president's top military advisors publicly acknowledging they did not support pulling all U.S. troops out of Afghanistan and implying they conveyed their concerns to the commander-in-chief.
My assessment was back in the fall of 20, and it remained consistent throughout, that we should keep a steady state of 2,500, and it could bounce up to 3,500, maybe something like that.
Did you ever present that assessment personally to President Biden?
I don't discuss exactly what my conversations are with the sitting president in the Oval Office, but I can tell you what my personal opinion was, and I'm always candid.
That contradicts what President Biden told George Stephanopoulos just over a month ago.
So no one told, your military advisors did not tell you, no, we should just keep 2,500 troops. It's been a stable situation for the last several years. We can do that. We can continue to do that.
No one said that to me that I can recall.
The head of U.S. Central Command, General McKenzie, going even further, saying he had given warning about what would happen if we didn't leave 2,500 troops behind.
And my view is that 2,500 was an appropriate number to remain, and that if we went below that number, in fact, we would probably witness a collapse of the Afghan government and the Afghan military. So,
General McKenzie, I guess my question is, would it be fair for the committee to assume that both President Trump and President Biden received that specific information?
I believe it would be reasonable for the committee to assume that.
But the Pentagon and the intelligence community also feeling the heat today. All the leaders testified they were surprised by the swift surrender of the Afghan forces, the Secretary of Defense admitting intelligence failures.
We didn't fully comprehend the depth of corruption and poor leadership in the senior ranks.
Today, Chairman Milley also addressing reports that in the waning days of the Trump administration, he reached out to his Chinese counterpart to assure him the U.S. was not preparing to attack China. According to the book Peril, intelligence showed China was concerned because of escalating rhetoric from former President Trump. Milley testifying he was told to reach out to China by the Secretary of Defense.
I know, I am certain, that President Trump did not intend to attack the Chinese. And it is my directed responsibility, and it was my directed responsibility by the Secretary, to convey that intent to the Chinese.
Milley insisting everyone from the Secretary of State Mike Pompeo to the White House Chief of Staff knew about this. And he pushed back on another story in the book that in a phone call with House Speaker Nancy Pelosi after the January 6th riot, he agreed with her assessment that Trump was crazy.
I'm not qualified to evaluate the mental fitness or the health of a former president, present president, or anybody else or anybody in this room. That's not my job. That's not what I do, and that's not what I did.
And we're joined by Martha Raddatz now. Martha, Chairman Milley was also pressed today about the danger in Afghanistan right now and whether he thinks the country will turn into a terrorist safe haven.
He was certainly asked that, and he acknowledged that al-Qaeda is still operating in Afghanistan, saying a reconstituted al-Qaeda or ISIS with aspirations to attack the United States is a very real possibility, and he summed up our 20-year war there, calling it a strategic failure, Phil.
Martha Raddatz, thank you. We're going to turn now to the high-stakes negotiations for President Biden's domestic agenda as Democrats debate the size and scope of what they will bring for a vote. The party divided over that larger spending bill and how high the price tag should be. As Speaker Pelosi says, she will move forward with a Thursday vote on the bipartisan $1 trillion physical infrastructure bill. ABC's Rachel Scott has the latest for us from Capitol Hill.
Tonight, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi refusing to say if she'll push back the vote on the bipartisan infrastructure bill for a second time.
Madam Speaker, will you still move forward with the vote on Thursday?
The $1 trillion package would rebuild the nation's roads and bridges. But progressives warn they'll vote no unless there's movement on the other, much larger infrastructure bill, too, with expanded child care, education, health care, and climate change.
So if there is no agreement on that larger economic package, you will vote no for the bipartisan package on Thursday?
I would vote no, and so would 50 others.
The president fighting to keep his economic agenda alive. Today, meeting with moderate Democratic Senators Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema.
They're really good, honest, straightforward negotiations.
Manchin still won't say how much he'd be willing to spend.
I think there's a lot of work needs to be done.
Democrats are also facing a string of critical deadlines. In less than 72 hours, the government is set to shut down. And today, the Treasury Secretary said the nation will default on its debt on October 18th if Congress does nothing.
Leader Schumer, so can you assure the American people that the nation will avoid a government shutdown?
We're doing everything we can to avoid a shutdown, and we should put something on the floor. We hope our Republican friends will join with us.
Rachel Scott joins us now. Rachel, we heard Senator Schumer there saying he hopes that Republicans will join Democrats to avoid a shutdown. But if that doesn't happen, do Democrats have a path to keeping the government open on their own? And what's the president doing in the middle of all of this?
Yeah, Phil, we really haven't heard much about a plan B from Majority Leader Chuck Schumer, but he says tonight that he believes that they will avert this government shutdown. President Biden, though, zeroing in on getting his economic agenda across the finish line. Late word tonight that the president has now canceled his trip to Chicago tomorrow. He was supposed to be there to encourage people to get vaccinated. The president now pushing that off. I just spoke to a White House official who told me that the president has been encouraged by the conversations that he has been having with leaders here on the Hill, and that he will continue that tomorrow, Phil.
Rachel, Thursday still looming large, obviously, on that infrastructure vote. If progressives stick to their guns and are voting on this without a deal on both bills, will the speaker likely have to back down again?
Yeah, Phil, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi has been clear that she does not come to the floor to lose. She really would not bring a bill to the floor unless she does believe that she has the vote. And so it is likely here that if an agreement is not reached, if Democrats do not break this stalemate, that we could see the Speaker of the House push back this vote for a few more days. But listen, she has already done this once. We know that Democrats want to get this across the finish line. They want to deliver on President Biden's agenda, Phil.
All eyes on Thursday. Rachel Scott, thank you. I'm joined now by Democrat Congresswoman Bonnie Watson Coleman of New Jersey, Vice Chair at Large of the Progressive Caucus. Congresswoman, thanks so much for taking the time with us tonight.
Thank you for having me.
You just heard Rachel Scott explain. Speaker Pelosi says she plans to go forward with the Thursday vote on the smaller infrastructure bill, even without an agreement on the larger $3.5 trillion spending package. Progressives have insisted on having both set before the voting. So the question I will ask you is the question everybody across the country would ask you if they were speaking to you right now. Will progressives vote against this bipartisan bill if it comes to the floor on Thursday?
You know, we're very much firmly in support of the president's Build Back Better agenda, both aspects of it, and we look forward to voting for it. But however, we do believe that the only way we can get the reconciliation issues addressed, the only way that we can get these long overdue improvements to health care, to child care, to access to higher education, expansion of Medicaid and Medicare, is if we get a firm commitment on the reconciliation bill first. And we've communicated that as a caucus of 96 on more than one occasion to both the White House, to the Senate, and to the House of Representatives.
Will you vote on Thursday if the other bill isn't in play on Thursday?
Well, I am hoping that we all understand that there is a significant reluctance or a significant commitment not to go forward with a bill that doesn't have the votes. And that would be the bricks and mortar bill before the reconciliation bill.
Okay. But as you know, this trillion-dollar infrastructure package has wide support from Americans from all parties and had bipartisan support in the Senate. So, again, and I'm sorry to harp on this, but how do you justify voting against it?
How do you justify not voting on this reconciliation bill, which is a drop in the bucket compared to other things that we've invested in? We just invested $7 trillion in defense, more than they even asked for. How do you justify not meeting the obligations that you engage in, that people voted for you, because you said that you would take care of issues regarding child care, take care of issues regarding access to higher education, equality in education, deal with issues of Medicaid and those red states where the states refuse to expand Medicaid, expand Medicare. At the end of the day, I think we have an obligation to fulfill those promises that we made. And I believe that the degree of support for that within the House of Representatives is illustrative of that commitment.
The Democrat Party seems a bit fractured. Do you think this hurts President Biden's agenda? And are you willing to do that to get what you want?
So I don't have any intentions of participating in ruining the president's agenda and the promises he made when he was running for office. I think the hugest difference between the Republican and Democratic Party is that it doesn't seem that there were sufficient core values other than just following what Trump was threatening if you didn't do. And being part of his coattail, I believe the Democratic Party is much more diverse. We all believe in those issues that are contained in the reconciliation bill, as well as the bricks and mortar bill. But we recognize that we may never get a chance to vote on the reconciliation issues if we first allow the bricks and mortar vote to go without a contest.
Okay, so before we get to the last question, just what are you thinking about Thursday? What do you think the outcome is?
I think that, there's so many sort of what ifs. What if we do this? What if we do that? I think that at the end of the day, it all works out. And we get to be able to vote on, at some point, both of these bills, because they're that crucial, that critical to our keeping our promises and the things that people need and people want. And that's from bridges to electric grid and to everything in between. But if we only engage in the bricks and mortar, then we are leaving out women in particular in the Build Back Better in this economy. We can no longer afford that.
Okay, and Congresswoman, just finally, while we have you on the looming debt ceiling deadline, we saw Senate Republicans again block an effort to raise the debt ceiling today, saying Democrats will have to do it through the reconciliation process with no GOP votes. So the question is, should Democrats bite the bullet here, do it on your own, so that the nation's financial standing isn't threatened?
So we got a couple of weeks to deal with this. The more immediate issue is the continuing resolution to make sure the government doesn't shut down on September the 30th. I think there are a number of options. We'll wait and see what the Senate sends back to us and how we address it. But at the end of the day, the debt ceiling bill would be addressed as well.
All right, Democrat Congresswoman Bonnie Watson Coleman, we do thank you for your time tonight. All eyes will no doubt be on Washington on Thursday. We hope to talk to you soon.
Thank you.
And today we are getting new details and learning new details about Brian Laundrie's whereabouts just days after he returned to Florida. The Laundrie family attorney now confirming a family camping trip. ABC's Trevor Ault brings us the latest.
Tonight, Gabby Petito's anguished parents speaking to the media for the first time since her body was discovered.
She's with us. She's with us.
Their lawyer demanding justice.
For Brian, we're asking you to turn yourself in to the FBI or the nearest law enforcement agency.
The FBI now in charge of the massive manhunt for Gabby's boyfriend, Brian Laundry. Over the weekend, his parents' attorney releasing a statement saying they don't know where he is and that speculation they helped him hide is just wrong. And tonight we're learning more about that encounter police had with the couple in Moab, Utah, days before Gabby's disappearance. The police report says Gabby tried to slap Brian and scratched him in the face. But the witness who called 911 claimed Brian was hitting Gabby. And the new dispatch audio confirms that's what officers were told.
RP states a male hit a female domestic. He got into a white Ford Transit van.
Today, Gabby's family unveiling matching tattoos designed and inspired by Gabby, reading Let It Be, vowing to help families of other missing people through a foundation in her name.
We need positive stuff to come from the tragedy that happened.
Our thanks to Trevor Ault. When we come back, the search in Florida, another search for a missing 19-year-old, and the investigation taking a turn after the person of interest is found dead. Creating bonds through music, the teacher helping Afghan Americans confront the trauma of what is happening in their homeland, one song at a time. But up next, the Free Britney movement could come to a close with the pop star getting out of her conservatorship. How we got to this moment, next.
All right, here we go. You ready? Let's do it.
Yes, it's the show America wants and America needs right now.
This is What Would You Do? Let's go. How are you?
Can I hug you?
Yes.
So what will you be watching Saturdays on ABC News Live?
What would you do?
Hey, I guess I just found out.
The What Would You Do Marathon, 12 to 6 Eastern, every Saturday on ABC News Live.
My favorite show.
This is what being live is all about. This is ABC News Live.
All right, we're going to move out. Let's move out.
We're surrounded by people
squeezing into this bomb shelter.
We're on an urgent delivery run.
Not afraid to go there.
So my question, Mr. President, what are you so afraid of?
Breaking news, live events.
This is the moment.
Liftoff.
Streaming straight to you, anytime, anywhere.
You just met one friend right here.
You're watching ABC News Live. Thanks for streaming with us.
Admit it. These days, what you need to know
seems to change just about every day.
What is it that you really want to know, need to know?
To help you not just get through your day,
but to make the most of it. Feel smarter.
Feel better.
Feel happier.
Well, how about a third hour of Good Morning America?
GMA 3, what you need to know. Now streaming on ABC News Live. It's all about you.
This is American history. A violent white mob. A brutal attack. 300 black Americans killed right here in America. Now, it is time to uncover Tulsa's buried truth. The gripping story brought to light in a new podcast from ABC News. Available now on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or your favorite podcast app.
Sex, gambling, fraud, betrayal, and murder. Cutthroat, Inc., the podcast. A family on a mission to find their son. A year's worth of conversations with the killer. Cutthroat, Inc. Subscribe for free now on your favorite podcast app. Assault on the Capitol, the ABC News original, exclusively on Hulu, now streaming. Now with so much on the line, more Americans are turning to David Muir and ABC's World News Tonight than any other program across all of television.
NBA superstar LeBron James has confirmed he has been vaccinated, but the future Hall of Famer did admit he was skeptical, then decided to get the shot for his family and friends. The NBA is requiring players to be either vaccinated or undergo rigorous testing, and that could put the season of a few high-profile players in jeopardy. Now to the hotly contested conservatorship of Britney Spears and tomorrow's high-stakes hearing that could end it all. Senators on Capitol Hill today held their own bipartisan hearing on what they called toxic conservatorships, looking at risks to vulnerable Americans all across the country. So was the so-called Free Britney movement right all along? And will Spears finally break free? Here's ABC's Kaylee Hartung.
I'm sure a lot of you guys are wondering how I'm doing. And since the cat is out of the bag, literally out of the bag, and you guys know my situation, I do want to let you guys know things are way better than what I ever anticipated.
Conservatorship has got to go.
One thing that everybody has lost sight of is what is in the best interest of Britney Spears.
Nearly every aspect of Britney Spears' life controlled for 13 years, and it could all end tomorrow.
Free Britney!
All eyes on this California courthouse, a judge to decide whether Spears will get the freedom she's been pleading for. In a recent legal filing, Spears' new high-power attorney, Matthew Rosengart, says following the release of a bombshell documentary from the New York Times, there is now overwhelming evidence for her father, Jamie, to be removed as her conservator immediately.
We will be moving promptly and aggressively for his removal.
After Spears' stunning testimony in June, amid pressure, even Jamie conceding that it's time for the conservatorship to end.
Jamie has now come in over the top and said, okay, you want me out, I'll do you one better. Let's end the whole conservatorship, and he's filed those papers.
But will ending it be that easy? Even with Spears now represented by the lawyer of her choosing, there may be some lasting hurdles.
It can and should probably end on the 29th, but I don't believe the court's going to act that quickly. And Matthew Rosengart himself has really proposed a plan to wind it down with a temporary conservator.
Since a public meltdown in 2008, the pop princess's finances remain under the control of her father, her career and personal life under court-appointed supervision too, even as she embarked on a wildly successful residency in Las Vegas. Multi-platinum album releases, a stint as a judge on The X Factor.
Britney, I felt like I had a connection with you.
But amid all the success, just after that 2008 court order, MTV documented a rare glimpse into how Britney felt about the conservatorship.
If I wasn't under the restraints that I'm under right now, you know, with all the lawyers and doctors and people analyzing me every day and all that kind of stuff, like, if that wasn't there, I'd feel so liberated and feel like myself. I'm sad.
Let Britney chill!
And in the New York Times Presents Controlling Britney Spears, insiders claim a wide-ranging surveillance operation monitored her private communications and much more.
Her phone, her own phone, and her own private conversations were used so often to control her.
In the documentary, a former employee of Black Box Security, Alex Vlasov, alleges Britney's phone was mirrored.
You would be able to see all messages, all FaceTime calls, notes, browser history, photographs.
The Times reporting that mirroring text messages without the consent of both parties could be a violation of the law, and that it is unclear if the court knew about or had approved any text message monitoring. Vlasov also claiming the security firm put an audio recording device in her bedroom. Spears' lawyer, former federal prosecutor Matthew Rosengart, telling ABC News, unauthorized recording or monitoring of Britney's communications represent an unconscionable and disgraceful violation of her privacy rights, adding placing a listening device in Britney's bedroom would be particularly horrifying and corroborates so much of her compelling, poignant testimony. In response to the allegations in the documentary, a lawyer for the head of Black Box told ABC News, Mr. Yemeni and Black Box Security have a strict policy against discussing matters concerning their clients or operations. But Mr. Yemeni and Black Box have always conducted themselves within professional, ethical, and legal bounds. And they are particularly proud of their work in keeping Ms. Spears safe for many years. And an attorney for Jamie Spears telling ABC News, Jamie loves Britney unwaveringly and wants only the best for her. All of his actions were well within the parameters of the authority conferred upon him by the court. His actions were done with the knowledge and consent of Britney, her court-appointed attorney, and/or the court. Spears revealing in a new Instagram post that she watched a little bit of one of those new documentaries, writing, "It's really crazy, guys," adding, "I scratched my head a couple of times. I really try to disassociate myself from the drama." The lead up to tomorrow, capping off a whirlwind summer for Spears, beginning in June when she publicly testified for the first time in court. In a nearly 30-minute call, an emotional Spears said, "I just want my life back, and I'm not here to be anyone's slave." Shock fans listening outside as she compared her experience of being forced to work to sex trafficking. The powerful testimony seen as vindication for her legions of fans and members of the Free Britney movement, who for years had been claiming something was wrong.
She knew that there were thousands and thousands of people out there who were 100% behind her.
I don't know where we would be today without, you know, the Free Britney movement. It's really hard to say, but I definitely doubt that there would be this much progress in her case.
The duo behind the account Britney's Gram dissects Spears' every social post.
I'm totally fine. I'm extremely happy. I have a beautiful home, beautiful children.
But now with Spears' feelings laid bare, the star even giving Babs and Tess a shout out on her social media and using the Free Britney hashtag too.
It was wild. I mean, it just said to us like, whoa, she's paying attention, you know, to this part of it.
The team continuing to dig, starting a podcast, Toxic.
I was in the courtroom on July 14th when she spoke again to the court, and she said that her conservators weren't allowing her to have coffee, which I know it seems like sort of a trivial thing, but that's such a basic thing to deny an adult a cup of coffee. And then you have this added layer of, if you're a Britney fan, you know how much she loves coffee.
We found out through our work that she had to use Bitcoin to just pay for apps on her phone.
Spears in a post earlier this month revealing her engagement to longtime boyfriend Sam Asghari. The 39-year-old had told the court she felt she wasn't allowed to marry while under the conservatorship. But Spears' posts still leave her fans guessing.
But after she posted that sort of subversive engagement video, that her Instagram got deleted. And then all of a sudden there's like old photos of her. So I think it remains sort of this place of mystery, honestly.
Babs and Tess will be at Spears' court hearing tomorrow, but they're also thinking about the thousands of others under conservatorship who don't have the superstar's passionate fan base.
The Free Britney movement is not just about Britney. It's about this systemic issue that Britney's story has helped shed light on. So I think even after Britney gets out, you're still going to see a lot of people in the Free Britney movement mobilized to fight for reform within the conservatorship system.
She couldn't free herself. She needed help, not from her lawyer. The judge didn't help her. It was her fans that helped her. And now we're seeing the end of the conservatorship.
Kaylee Hartung joins us now. And Kaylee, Britney and Jamie Spears have both asked for this conservatorship to end. So a two-part question here. What's holding up dissolving it, and what can we expect from tomorrow's hearings?
Yeah, so Phil, on the surface, it looks like the two sides want the same thing, but you have to keep in mind they are coming at that end goal from very different lenses. Britney Spears' team wants Jamie Spears removed from the conservatorship first. They say that is step one in the two-step process of eventually terminating the conservatorship this fall, having it formally wound down, perhaps a temporary conservator put in place in the meantime, because they recognize this is a long process that could take time, unwinding this legal agreement. I think there is some vindication they are seeking to hear a judge say it is not in Britney Spears' best interest for her father to have any more control over his life than he already has for the past 13 years. And Britney's attorney will tell you, Jamie Spears' approach here of now suddenly making this about face and saying, I think it's time to dissolve this conservatorship. They say that that is him really trying to save face, sort of a defense tactic, if you will, of his own after he has been accused of, as Britney has called it, manning this abusive conservatorship for all of this time. So again, they want the same things, but they're going about it by very different means from very different perspectives. Jamie, getting that conservatorship terminated tomorrow, perhaps, would mean that he's absolving himself from the wrath, the harsh criticism he would then receive if he was removed. And a lot of people think that that's what he is trying to do instead of keeping Britney Spears' best interest in mind, which is what this is all about. And that is the goal of tomorrow, to hear from a judge what is in Britney Spears' best interest, Phil.
And with that in mind, do we know yet if we are going to hear from Britney herself in court tomorrow?
We don't, Phil. We have not been able to get confirmation from Britney's attorney that she will or will not speak. But if you're a betting man, I'm willing to bet that we will hear from Britney tomorrow. That testimony she gave back in June, that first time we heard her speak publicly about the conservatorship and the way it has ruled her life to the harshest degree, That was powerful. And that is what her team is going to be leaning on, her own words, to describe what she's experienced and why Jamie Spears should no longer have control over her. We then heard her speak again in a subsequent hearing, not because it was planned, but because she wanted to. We are hearing Brittany empowered, wanting to speak her mind. And again, if I'm betting on it, I think we'll hear from her tomorrow.
Well, you've been covering it since the beginning, so I'll double down on your bet. Kaylee Hartung, thanks so much. Still ahead here on Prime, Simone Biles opening up about her mental state and what she says she should have done before the Tokyo Olympics. President Obama speaking exclusively with our Robin Roberts, what he thinks about President Biden's struggles getting his agenda passed through a Democrat-led Congress. And James Bond is back again. We take a look by the numbers. But first, our tweet of the day.
There is no planet blah, 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 blah.
Greta Thunberg blasting leaders as the climate crisis grows worse for offering hope but not taking meaningful action. And remember, our special Year of Extremes airs after Prime at 8:30 Eastern, 9:30 Pacific.
We will guide you through it all tonight. We have made it through another week together.
Give me a big hug, Brittany.
We taught all our patients how much they are loved to hold their hands.
David, we're showing our love and support for all the ICU staff.
They're the heroes in this.
It was an extraordinary story.
A computer salesman was supposed to report to prison to begin a 17-year sentence.
They let him turn himself into jail with no escort.
No one thought he would run.
How do you evade capture for 25 years? How do you do that?
Now, join the search, following the U.S. Marshals as they uncover new leads in a global manhunt. Can you help catch this fugitive?
Have you seen this man?
Have you seen this man?
Have you seen this man? Listen and join the all-new Hunt wherever you get your podcasts.
The world may feel out of your control, but your happiness doesn't have to be. Learn the secrets to happiness. Listen to the 10% Happier podcast, free on Apple Podcasts.
Now, with so much on the line, more Americans are turning to David Muir and ABC's World News Tonight than any other program across all of television.
This is GMA3, what you need to know.
GMA3.
A third hour of Good Morning America in the afternoon.
It's all about you. Lunchtime on ABC.
This is what being live is all about. This is ABC News Live.
All right, we're going to move back. Let's move back.
We're surrounded by people
squeezing into this bomb shelter.
We're on urgent delivery run.
Not afraid to go there.
So my question, Mr. President, what are you so afraid of?
Breaking news, live events.
This is the moment.
Streaming straight to you, anytime, anywhere.
You just met one friend right here.
You're watching ABC News Live. Thanks for streaming with us.
Now streaming on ABC News Live, 2020, true crime, cinematic, real-life drama, stunning, the unthinkable, follow the clues, the hunt, true crime, 2020, now streaming on ABC News Live. The most powerful stories of our time, anytime, Nightline.
Welcome back, everyone. After a year of delays caused by the pandemic, James Bond is back with tonight's world premiere of No Time to Die. Let's take a look by the numbers. Originally scheduled for April 2020, the premiere was pushed back three times in the past year because of the pandemic. But now, after a UK rollout this weekend, the film will get its full theatrical release in the US October 8th. Four members of the royal family came out for tonight's world premiere in London, with Prince Charles and Camilla, as well as William and Kate, all in attendance. No Time to Die is the 25th film in the series and is the fifth and final film featuring actor Daniel Craig as Bond. Craig first took over the role 007 15 years ago in Casino Royale and last played Bond 6 years ago in 2015's Spectre. Six actors have played Bond over the decades, with the franchise kicking off 59 years ago in 1962 with Sir Sean Connery in Dr. No. Actor Roger Moore has played Bond the most, with seven films in the iconic role, but there is still no word yet on who the next James Bond will be. We still have a lot to get to here on Prime. The woman accused of starting a wildfire and what she claims she was trying to do when it sparked. And why some Oreo cookies are reselling for thousands of dollars. But first, a look at our top trending stories on abcnews.com.
An extraordinary story.
A computer salesman was supposed to report to prison to begin a 17-year sentence.
They let him turn himself into jail with no escort.
No one thought he would run.
How do you evade capture for 25 years? How do you do that?
Now, join the search, following the U.S. Marshals as they uncover new leads in a global manhunt. Can you help catch this fugitive?
Have you seen this man?
Have you seen this man?
Have you seen this man? Listen and join the all-new hunt wherever you get your podcasts.
The most powerful stories of our time, anytime. Nightline. Now streaming on ABC News Live 2020. True crime. Cinematic. Real life drama. Stunning. The unthinkable. Follow the clues. The hunt. True crime. 2020. Now streaming on ABC News Live.
Admit it. These days, what you need to know
seems to change just about every day.
What is it that you really want to know, need to know?
To help you not just get through your day,
but to make the most of it. Feel smarter.
Feel better.
Feel happier.
Well, how about a third hour of Good Morning America?
GMA 3, what you need to know. Now streaming on ABC News Live.
It's all about you.
All right, here we go. You ready? Let's do it.
Yes, it's the show America wants and America needs right now.
This is What Would You Do? Let's go. How are you?
I hug you.
Yes.
So what will you be watching Saturdays on ABC News Live?
What would you do?
Hey, I guess I just found out.
The What Would You Do Marathon, 12 to 6 Eastern, every Saturday on ABC News Live.
My favorite show.
This is what being live is all about. This is ABC News Live.
All right, we're going to move back. Let's move back.
We're surrounded by people
squeezing into this bomb shelter.
We're on an urgent delivery run.
Not afraid to go there.
So my question, Mr. President, what are you so afraid of?
Breaking news, live events.
This is the moment.
Streaming straight to you, anytime, anywhere.
You just met one friend right here.
You're watching ABC News Live. Thanks for streaming with us.
Pentagon leaders are in the hot seat, facing a grilling on Capitol Hill about the chaotic U.S. troop withdrawal from Afghanistan. Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin, Joint Chiefs of Staff Chairman Mark Milley, and Commander of the U.S. Central Command General Kenneth McKenzie addressing the end of America's longest war.
We absolutely missed the rapid 11-day collapse of the Afghan military and the collapse of their government.
As lawmakers blasted the officials for how they handled the evacuations, generals testified that they opposed Biden's decision to withdraw all troops.
I recommended that we maintain 2,500 troops in Afghanistan, and I'm confident that the president heard all the recommendations.
And the man responsible for the murders of five employees of Maryland's Capital Gazette newspaper will spend the rest of his life in jail. The state attorney's office says Jared Ramos was sentenced to five life sentences without the possibility of parole after he was found guilty of perpetrating one of the worst attacks on journalists in U.S. history. Ramos entered the newspaper's offices in 2018. And he opened fire, killing five people. They're injuring two others. He pleaded insanity, but that attempt was denied by a jury.
The former yoga teacher charged with felony arson for starting the devastating Fawn Fire in Northern California reportedly told authorities that she was trying to boil water she believed had bear urine in it. 30-year-old Alexandra Suverneva allegedly stopped to ready drinking water for herself while hiking towards Canada. The resulting blaze has now scorched more than 8,500 acres and destroyed more than 180 structures. Suverneva has pleaded not guilty.
Mia Marcano is still missing, and her family is still searching.
Mia, this message is for you. I know you're alive.
I know you're out there.
And the Valencia College student's family still pleads for the public to help bring the 19-year-old home.
We believe in hope and we have faith.
Orange County Sheriff John Mina announced their person of interest in this case. 27-year-old Armando Manuel Caballero was found dead in Seminole County of an apparent suicide. Mina went on to explain Caballero was romantically interested in Marcano, but she repeatedly turned down his advances.
Simone Biles is getting candid about her time at the Tokyo Olympics. In a recent interview with New York Magazine, the 24-year-old gymnast and four-time Olympic gold medalist revealing that she was struggling well before her shocking withdrawal from the team final at the 2020 Tokyo Olympics, saying, I should have quit way before Tokyo when Larry Nassar was in the media for 2 years. It was too much, but I was not going to let him take something I've worked for since I was 6 years old. I wasn't going to let him take that joy away from me. Miles also sharing a tearful video from the day she withdrew from competition in the most recent episode of her Facebook Watch series.
I'm afraid I'm going to get hurt because I'm not doing the correct flip.
Gotta catch 'em all!
Now you have the chance to catch them all, too. Oreo Cookies have partnered with Pokemon on limited edition cookies featuring the images of 16 Pokemon. Each pack contains a random assortment of favorites like Pikachu and Charmander. But it's the ones featuring rare Pokemon like Mew that are causing all the buzz. Collectors are selling the elusive Mew cookies on eBay, some listed for tens of thousands of dollars. For those who are willing to take their chances, however, a regular Pokemon Oreo pack runs about $4.
Welcome back. North Korea tonight has released a new image of yet another missile they launched just about 2 hours ago. They're describing it as a, quote, newly developed hypersonic missile. It was the reclusive nation's third launch this month and comes just a few days after the North proposed talks with their South Korean neighbors. Tonight, a U.S. official is downplaying the notion this test launch was, in fact, a hypersonic missile. Earlier today, former President Obama, along with First Lady Michelle Obama, officially broke ground at the Obama Presidential Center in Chicago. Mr. Obama said he chose Chicago because of the role it played in both his personal and professional life, saying it's where he learned, quote, the power of place and the power of people. ABC's Robin Roberts sat down with the former president exclusively, and he got candid about life after the White House.
You are embracing your post-presidency. What has it been like for you? How are things?
Things have been fantastic. More time with Michelle, more time with the girls. We have been very excited about the programs that our foundation has launched.
So much going on right now, and you know President Biden extremely well. And this is a really important moment in his administration,
right,
needing to pass comprehensive legislation,
right,
and even within the Democratic Party, there seems to be some divide. How do you think he is handling this particular moment, and what does he need to do to pass his agenda?
The Build Back America program is something that America desperately needs. When you look at the overall package, you know, it's got a headline price tag of $3.5 trillion, but that's not a single year. This is spread out over a number of years. And most importantly, it's paid for by asking the wealthiest of Americans to pay a few percentage points more in taxes in order to make sure that we have an economy that's fair for everybody. So,
but should they be concerned that that's how they're going to have to pay for it?
They can afford it. We can afford it. I put myself in this category now. And I think anybody who pretends that it's a hardship for billionaires to pay a little bit more in taxes so that a single mom gets childcare support, or so that we're doing something about climate change for the next generation, you know, that's an argument that is unsustainable. And as far as Democrats are concerned, I think President Biden is handling it exactly right.
So you feel confident it's going to pass?
I believe that it will get done. It'll be messy, as it's always messy to get big, serious legislation done.
The other big story, the images coming out from the border in Texas with the Haitian immigrants. In 2010, when they had that devastating earthquake, your administration allowed Haitians under a special temporary legal status here in the U.S., but now we're seeing, under the current administration, sending them back to an island in crisis, not only the earthquake, the assassination of their president. How do you square what we're seeing right now?
Unfortunately, comprehensive immigration reform has consistently gotten stuck, partly because we can't get enough Republicans to support it. What happened at the Texas border is a painful reminder that we don't have this right yet.
And you can understand Americans seeing those images coming out of the border right now, how it's just, it's very difficult to see.
It is heartbreaking, and it is, I think, one of those situations in which if you have a system that overall is dysfunctional, you are going to get episodes in which what's happening right in front of you is something that nobody wants.
Having been in the White House for 8 years, when you are turning on the news, how do you handle it?
We've gone through really tough times in this country. Much worse than this. Each of us doing our part, I think, is the best way to deal with anxiety. Mm. You know, my mother always used to tell me, you know, if you're feeling anxious, go get busy. Do something.
Another issue on the former president's mind, widespread gun violence in his beloved city of Chicago, over 600 murders already this year.
Talk about something I wanted to get done that I couldn't get done, was get smarter, common sense, gun safety measures in place through Congress. But what we can do is potentially give young people the sense that there's another way for them to empower themselves.
The Obamas are doing just that with the groundbreaking of the Obama Presidential Center right in the heart of the South Side.
You have the home where Michelle grew up. You have my first apartment. So part of the reason we're here is because just about everything that's important to me in my life started here. There's young people who are enormously talented, but often forgotten. And so for us to be able to build a world-class institution that will attract millions of people, hopefully will send a signal that those young people count, those young people matter.
Our thanks to Robin Roberts tonight. And finally, America Strong, an Afghan-American, is settling into his new high school tonight after a traumatic summer trip ended in his homeland with the Taliban taking over. And tonight, he is finding healing in music with the help of a new teacher. Our Kenneth Moten reports.
This 13-year-old's love for music is now the compass for his healing.
Terrific, up to G.
Mustafa Arya and his family, proud Afghan Americans, were visiting Kabul for the summer when the Taliban takeover escalated. They fled with the clothes on their backs.
It was pretty hard. We had like 4 attempts and 3 of them were unsuccessful. And the last day was like 10 a.m. We found our way inside the airport. And when I saw the U.S. soldiers, I felt like I was in U.S. because like I felt safe.
So can you play me 8 notes?
With the help of his music teacher, Russell Daisy, Mustafa is learning to play the piano in the safety of his Virginia apartment, writing songs about the homeland he once knew. It's all much-needed music therapy.
It's everything for me. When I am kind of like depressed and stuff, when I play music, I focus a lot to not to mess up. Like I forget everything else, and that kind of helps me in a way.
The teen and his family are recovering from the trauma and the terror of escaping Afghanistan.
I experienced a lot of traumatic event, like emotional and physical torturing. The children was witness of beating when they have beaten me, the children or my wife, because of that. Yeah, it was like not only physical trauma, it was emotional and physical trauma for us.
In just 3 days after returning home to the U.S., the resilient Virginia teen did what most American teenagers do. He went to his first day of high school.
We arrived on Friday and I went to school Monday.
What was that like? Knowing that where you were on Friday, like, and then where were you on Monday at school?
When I went to school, lots of my friends didn't know that I arrived. They were pretty shocked.
to help Mustafa cope and work through any trauma. Family friend Dr. Judy Koryansky bought Mustafa an electric piano and connected him with Daisy.
I said to Dr. Judy, I said, I want to teach him piano. Come on, I want to do this. I need to do this. My heart was saying to me, this boy needed music. He needed a form of expression. He loved music so much from his past.
The music lessons providing a safe space to process the unspeakable.
Teenagers are traumatized and ashamed of their feelings. They suffer from what I call the three S's. One is terrible shame, then silence about how they're feeling, and terrible stigma. Something's wrong with me. And then the depression sets in. Along with depression is anger.
Mustafa, who also plays the harmonium, took his instrument to Afghanistan. But because the Taliban is known for banning music, Mustafa's harmonium went silent.
So you had to leave your instrument in Afghanistan.
Mm-hmm. The Taliban doesn't like music, so I was pretty scared. And what I was doing was just trying to hide my instrument, like from one place to another place. I was moving it, and finally I just like left it somewhere. And I'm pretty sure my family in Afghanistan right now is doing the same thing, trying to hide it, because I left it there.
When I asked him about his experiences, he said, I didn't feel comfortable toward the end of my time in Afghanistan this summer, even playing. He wasn't comfortable singing because it basically marked him as someone who could be, as we well know, visited with hostility.
Finding a sense of purpose through the power of music.
It sounds like a real keyboard again.
My hope for him is that he can, even through his song, communicate with his relatives and communicate with the rest of the world.
Mustafa's music, his North Star, but it's also filling his home, helping his entire family on that long journey toward healing.
I miss my home, Afghanistan. I mean, that's my country, and the music I play belongs to Afghanistan. I really wanna go back there and play music because lots of people want me to play, and I actually do wanna go play, so that's my dream.
Kenneth Moten, ABC News, Washington.
Kenneth, thank you. We're glad he's singing again. Before we go tonight, the image of the day, take a look. These people are picking grapes in France that will later become wine, of course, but using a type of technology that protects crops from climate hazards. That's our show for this hour. Stay tuned to ABC News Live for more context and analysis of the day's top stories. I'm Phil Lipoff. Thanks for streaming with us. And coming up in the next hour, we are staying on top of several things, including the supply chain delays that continue to grow worse. They started during the COVID lockdowns, but those are over. So why are shoppers increasingly finding empty shelves? And our conversation with the first defendant to be sentenced in the college cheating scandal known as Operation Varsity Blues.
Being live is all about. This is ABC News Live.
All right, we're gonna move back. Let's move back.
We're surrounded by people
squeezing into this bomb shelter.
We're on an urgent delivery run.
Not afraid to go there.
So my question, Mr. President, what are you so afraid of?
Breaking news, live events.
This is the moment.
Lift off.
streaming straight to you, anytime, anywhere.
You just met one friend right here.
You're watching ABC News Live. Thanks for streaming with us.
It was an extraordinary story.
A computer salesman was supposed to report to prison to begin a 17-year sentence.
They let him turn himself into jail with no escort.
No one thought he would run.
How do you evade capture for 25 years? How do you do that?
Now, join the search, following the U.S. Marshals as they uncover new leads in a global manhunt. Can you help catch this fugitive?
Have you seen this man?
Have you seen this man?
Have you seen this man? Listen and join the all-new Hunt wherever you get your podcasts.
The world may feel out of your control, but your happiness doesn't have to be. Learn the secrets to happiness. Listen to the 10% Happier podcast, free on Apple Podcasts.
Robin Roberts, George Stephanopoulos, Michael Strahan. Wake up with America's number one most watched morning show, ABC's
Good Morning America.
I'm Phil Lipoff. Thanks for streaming with us tonight. We are monitoring several developments here at ABC News at this hour. The former Marine accused of shooting and killing a sheriff's deputy in Florida is now under arrest. Police reportedly caught up to him after nearly five-day manhunt. The former military member's father claims he suffers from PTSD and depression. Gabby Petito's parents and step-parents addressed the media today, announcing a new foundation in her name. It will aim to help other families looking for missing loved ones. The FBI manhunt for Brian Laundrie, her boyfriend, continues. And they call it snail mail for a reason. We are learning tonight the Postal Service is about to get slower. First-class mail sent long distances could take a day or two longer to arrive, but mail sent within the same area is expected to maintain current delivery times. Now to Capitol Hill, where America's top military leaders were grilled about the chaotic and deadly U.S. withdrawal from Afghanistan. They appeared actually to contradict President Biden when they said they did recommend leaving a small U.S. force to stay in Afghanistan. ABC's chief global affairs correspondent Martha Raddatz reports.
Good morning.
It was an extraordinary moment. For the first time, the president's top military advisors publicly acknowledging they did not support pulling all U.S. troops out of Afghanistan and implying they conveyed their concerns to the commander-in-chief.
My assessment was back in the fall of 20, and it remained consistent throughout, that we should keep a steady state of 2,500, and it could bounce up to 3,500, maybe something like that.
Did you ever present that assessment personally to President Biden?
I don't discuss exactly what my conversations are with the sitting president in the Oval Office, but I can tell you what my personal opinion was, and I'm always candid.
That contradicts what President Biden told George Stephanopoulos just over a month ago.
So no one told, your military advisors did not tell you, no, we should just keep 2,500 troops. It's been a stable situation for the last several years. We can do that. We can continue to do that.
No one said that to me that I can recall.
The head of U.S. Central Command, General McKenzie, going even further, saying he had given warning about what would happen if we didn't leave 2,500 troops behind.
And my view is that 2,500 was an appropriate number to remain, and that if we went below that number, in fact, we would probably witness a collapse of the Afghan government and the Afghan military. So,
General McKenzie, I guess my question is, would it be fair for the committee to assume that both President Trump and President Biden received that specific information?
I believe it would be reasonable for the committee to assume that.
But the Pentagon and the intelligence community also feeling the heat today. All the leaders testified they were surprised by the swift surrender of the Afghan forces, the Secretary of Defense admitting intelligence failures.
We didn't fully comprehend the depth of corruption and poor leadership in the senior ranks.
Today, Chairman Milley also addressing reports that in the waning days of the Trump administration, he reached out to his Chinese counterpart to assure him the U.S. was not preparing to attack China. According to the book Peril, intelligence showed China was concerned because of escalating rhetoric from former President Trump. Milley testifying he was told to reach out to China by the Secretary of Defense.
I know, I am certain, that President Trump did not intend to attack the Chinese. And it is my directed responsibility, and it was my directed responsibility by the Secretary, to convey that intent to the Chinese.
Milley insisting everyone from the Secretary of State Mike Pompeo to the White House Chief of Staff knew about this. And he pushed back on another story in the book that in a phone call with House Speaker Nancy Pelosi after the January 6th riot, he agreed with her assessment that Trump was crazy.
I'm not qualified to evaluate the mental fitness or the health of a former president, present president, or anybody else or anybody in this room. That's not my job. That's not what I do, and that's not what I did.
Martha Raddatz reporting tonight. Martha, thank you. Now to the supply chain delays growing worse tonight. The disruptions that started with the COVID lockdowns have led to record numbers of container ships waiting at U.S. ports to be unloaded. Businesses are waiting for key parts. Shoppers are finding some empty shelves again. Here's ABC's Kaylee Hartung.
Tonight, empty shelves lining more stores nationwide. Some retailers complaining product shortages are becoming as bad as they were at the start of the pandemic. Costco once again limiting purchases of toilet paper and paper towels. From Nike to Apple, American businesses feeling the pinch. The Delta variant hitting Asian economies hard, meaning fewer goods are being produced.
I'd get going right away. If you want something under the Christmas tree, the proverbial tree, you might want to start shopping now because it's going to take some time to get it delivered.
COVID-19 disruptions causing a lack of workers at every part of the supply chain. Fewer dock workers and truckers means record bottlenecks of cargo ships off both coasts.
Whether you're waiting on that couch you ordered to get delivered or maybe trying to get ahead of your holiday shopping, those goods might be stuck right here. Between the Port of Los Angeles and here in the Port of Long Beach, nearly 100 ships are out here just waiting for a place to dock.
Dozens more stuck waiting off the ports in New York and New Jersey. With demand remaining strong, major retailers like Walmart and Target are even chartering their own ships in order to stock their shelves.
Our thanks to Kaylee. The federal government will shut down unless Congress passes a funding bill. And in another looming deadline, the Treasury Secretary now says the U.S. risks defaulting on its debt by October 18th. Lawmakers are desperately scrambling to reach an agreement to avoid either scenario. ABC's Elizabeth Schulze has more from Washington.
Amid gridlock in Congress, time is running out to avert a government shutdown and U.S. debt crisis.
Keeping the government open and preventing default is vital to our country's future, and Democrats are going to make sure we do not lapse on either.
Without a funding agreement, the government will shut down at midnight Thursday. That could mean thousands of federal workers get furloughed, including 43% of Department of Health and Human Services staff.
Having services shut down, staffing cut in different agencies is not in the interests of addressing any crisis we face.
And Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen now says the government won't be able to pay its bills unless Congress raises the debt limit by October 18th, a scenario she calls catastrophic as nearly 50 million Americans wouldn't receive Social Security payments.
It would be disastrous for the American economy, for global financial markets, and for millions of families and workers whose financial security would be jeopardized by delayed payments.
Republicans are standing firm, insisting Democrats must include a debt ceiling hike as part of their $3.5 trillion budget bill.
If Democrats want to use fast-track, party-line procedures to ram through trillions more in inflationary socialism, they'll have to use the same tools to handle the debt limit.
Democrats are still trying to iron out their differences over their budget bill, which includes funding for universal pre-K, paid maternity leave, free community college, and investments to fight climate change. Moderate Senators Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema meeting with the president at the White House as they try to reach an agreement.
Now, there's one more piece to this puzzle in Congress, and that's the roughly $1 trillion bipartisan infrastructure bill. It's on track for a final House vote on Thursday, but Senator Bernie Sanders is urging progressives to block it until that broader budget bill is passed. Phil?
Elizabeth, thank you. 2021 has been a year of weather extremes, we all know. Rampant wildfires, tropical storms, hurricanes, including the deadly and destructive Ida just earlier this month. Ginger Z sat down with John Kerry, who is running point on climate change for the White House, to talk about our changing world.
In less than a month, the leaders of the world will meet in Glasgow, Scotland, to attack the climate crisis at a conference called COP26.
To keep within our reach the vital goal of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius, every nation needs to bring their highest possible ambitions to the table when we meet in Glasgow for COP26.
Many of the promises made in Paris 5 years ago have failed. I got to sit down with the White House climate czar, John Kerry, to see how this time needs to be different. Ambition without action is fantasy. How do we go from fantasy and make sure that doesn't happen and get measured result from 2 weeks in Glasgow?
This is the moment that scientists told us. Mm-hmm. We have now about 9 years within which to make the most important decisions that get us there.
I think Greta Thunberg says this is what betrayal looks like. Whatever our so-called leaders are doing, they're doing it wrong. And it made us think about that. It is a beautiful image of you signing the Paris Agreement with your granddaughter Isabel on your lap, and that's just 5 years ago or so. Do you think that as a globe, the leaders have failed, Isabel?
Well, a lot of them have failed, but I think it's unfair. And I understand Greta's frustration and anger. She's absolutely right to be pressing the urgency of our doing that. But there are leaders out there trying to get some things done, and we've got to speed it up.
Ginger, thank you. And be sure to check out our Year of Extremes. Our James Longman also goes to Greenland to see the ice melt firsthand. It's airing at 8:30 Eastern, 9:30 Pacific. And of course, you can stream it later on Hulu. We're going to turn now to the continuing fallout from the college cheating scandal known as Operation Varsity Blues. Former Stanford University sailing coach John Vandemore was the first defendant to be sentenced in the scandal that's ensnared dozens of wealthy families, including Full House actress Lori Loughlin and her husband, and actress Felicity Huffman. Vandemore documents his experiences in his new book, Rigged Justice: How the College Admissions Scandal Ruined an Innocent Man's Life. John joins us now. John, thanks for being here with us tonight.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
All right, so you pleaded guilty to one count of racketeering conspiracy for accepting bribes from alleged mastermind Rick Singer in exchange for designating Stanford applicants as official sailing recruits, but you maintain that you're not guilty. So why did you enter that plea?
Well, I really entered the plea because it was the best decision for my family. Winning for me, if I stayed and fought it, would be spending millions of dollars on lawyer fees, waiting for over a year with COVID, have been well over a year to even defend myself. And at that point, my career was already going to be over. So the quickest way for me to kind of move forward was to plea.
The judge called you, and we should point this out, the least culpable defendant in the case because the $500,000 that you accepted from Singer went directly to Stanford's sailing program and not into your own pocket. So is that a key point for you? And do you think this, you know, the lack of personal enrichment here in some way excuses your role in the scheme?
I really think it's a key part of it. And there's two key parts. One is that I didn't accept any money at all. All of it went to Stanford University, written to Stanford University, handed to their development officers. But the other part of it is that no student even applied to Stanford. So the admissions office didn't even have to read a single application in this.
So let's talk about that for a minute, because I think a lot of people followed this entire story from beginning to even now as trials are going on, certainly your personal story. And a lot of people are thinking, well, he accepted a plea, and we know people who are not guilty accept pleas all the time. But there were no red flags that went up for you, even though this money wasn't going into your pocket. There were hundreds of thousands of dollars coming in and going to the school. Did you think that was just normal?
I really did. We've had incredible generous donors for Stanford in the past, and I thought this was just part of it. I was really relying on the school to help me, educate me, and protect me in this, but I was wrong.
And in the book, you make that clear. You feel betrayed by the school. How so?
I do, because their lack of education, and by their own admittance in their press releases, that they could have done more to educate coaches like myself to help with this, and they just didn't do it.
All right, so let's go back a few years. You describe in the book being in your pajamas, opening the door, finding an FBI, an IRS agent on your doorstep. And in the following months, your life just came crashing down in a very, very public way. What were some of the worst moments for you?
Well, two very scary moments is, one, opening that door in the first place and seeing two agents standing outside my door and not knowing what it was about at all. And then really finding out later that I was the person they were looking for, that I was the person that they were trying to get into this and trying to charge. And that was incredibly tough. I dropped to my knees and started crying the second I even heard that.
I think a lot of people are going to be interested in reading the account of someone who was involved in this, but why did you choose to publish your book right now when there are still trials pending in other huge cases?
Well, it actually wasn't planned that way. COVID kind of made everything delayed, the trials and my book, but it came out at the same time. You know, and I think it's even better for it. You know, I wrote this book for my children, for my family, for my friends to hear my story. But I also wrote it as a warning for my colleagues, for anybody that can be caught up with a large corporation like this. And I think it's good timing to take recognition of this.
John, two quick final questions for you. First, what lessons have you learned from all this? And what are you doing now? Will you ever coach at the collegiate level again?
Yeah, I learned a lot from this, but I think the biggest takeaway for me is perspective. Really looking at what's being offered and handed to me and surrounding myself with people that I can really trust and that are loyal to me and I'm loyal to them. It's really about community. I think we all learned that at COVID, and it certainly is prevalent for me. For me now, I'm coaching kids. I coach a group of 10 to 13-year-olds, and I really like that. I really love it. And I've kind of moved on careers that I'm working as an engineer now for a potable water company, and I really like that as well. I've got great colleagues, and I'm enjoying my community.
And finally, we all know it's kind of hard to unring a bell. You took a plea. Your name was, you know, all over this scandal. You know, certainly not, you know, like Lori Loughlin's and, you know, people who are famous like that. But certainly people know your name because of this. Do you think there will be a time where anybody looks at you and says, oh, that was the guy who was involved in that. He took a plea. He's obviously guilty. And you say you're not guilty. You took the plea. Do you think that stays with you, that label stays with you for the rest of your life?
It does. I mean, there's no way around it. I mean, if you look on Wikipedia or anything else about the case, my name is listed there with everybody else. But that's not really what I'm concerned with. I really wanted to tell my story out there so my family, the people that know me, my friends, more importantly, my kids, I have a 5- and 3-year-old, they can hear my story from my words, and that's really what matters.
All right, and there it is. John Vandemore, thank you so much. Rigged Justice, How the College Admissions Scandal Ruined an Innocent Man's Life is available wherever books are sold. And still to come, the beachgoers still sunbathing near a volcano, and the World War II veteran who finally met his pen pal.
All right, here we go. You ready? Let's do it.
Yes, it's the show America wants and America needs right now.
This is What Would You Do? Let's go. How are you?
I hug you.
Yes.
So what will you be watching Saturdays on ABC News Live?
What would you do?
Hey, I guess I just found out.
The What Would You Do Marathon, 12 to 6 Eastern, every Saturday on ABC News Live.
My favorite show.
This is what being live is all about. This is ABC News Live.
All right, we're going to move back. Let's move back.
We're surrounded by people
squeezing into this bomb shelter.
We're on an urgent delivery run.
Not afraid to go there.
So my question, Mr. President, what are you so afraid of?
Breaking news, live events.
This is the moment.
Let's go.
Streaming straight to you, anytime, anywhere.
You just met one friend right here.
You're watching ABC News Live. Thanks for streaming with us.
Admit it. These days, what you need to know
seems to change just about every day.
What is it that you really want to know, need to know?
To help you not just get through your day,
but to make the most of it. Feel smarter.
Feel better.
Feel happier.
Well, how about a third hour of Good Morning America?
GMA 3, What You Need to Know. Now streaming on ABC News Live. It's all about you.
This is American history. A violent white mob, a brutal attack. 300 black Americans killed right here in America. Now, it is time to uncover Tulsa's buried truth. The gripping story brought to light in a new podcast from ABC News. Available now on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or your favorite podcast app.
This is a story about a woman who pretended to be someone that she's not.
She woke up one morning and she decided to be somebody else.
And she did.
It was amazing until it wasn't.
A so-called Soho grifter, guilty on 8 counts.
you're just a few weeks out of prison. How would you describe the real Anna Delvey?
Oh, that's such a loaded question.
So pay me my money.
The Fake Heiress, 2020, Friday night on ABC.
Pay me my money.
Sex, gambling, fraud, betrayal, and murder. Cutthroat Inc., the podcast. A family on a mission to find their son. A year's worth of conversations with the killer. Cutthroat Inc. Subscribe for free now on your favorite podcast app. Assault on the Capitol, the ABC News original, exclusively on Hulu, now streaming. Now with so much on the line, more Americans are turning to David Muir and ABC's World News Tonight than any other program across all of television.
Welcome back, everyone. We are tracking several international headlines at this hour as well. Some residents were not deterred at all from getting a tan and swimming just a few miles from the volcano that continues to spew lava in La Palma. This as the government of Spain officially declared the island a disaster zone. When asked if he was concerned, one beachgoer simply said, quote, "The beach relaxes you." Many in China woke up to complete darkness as power cuts continue to happen in an effort to meet energy efficiency and pollution targets. Factories in China have also been ordered to suspend production, which, as you would imagine, poses a threat to the global flow of smartphones and other goods made in China. Farmers have taken to the streets of Bolivia for days to demand control of the coca markets. The growers are demanding leadership roles in the regional Coca Farmers Association. For centuries, people of the Andes have chewed coca leaves to ward off the impacts of high altitude, and it is even considered sacred by many indigenous peoples. Earlier today, former President Barack Obama, along with First Lady Michelle Obama, officially broke ground at the Obama Presidential Center in Chicago. Obama said he chose Chicago because of the role it played in both his personal and professional lives, saying it is where he learned, quote, the power of place and the power of people. Our very own Robin Roberts got an exclusive look at some of the special items you can plan to see at the center with President Obama himself.
So part of it is that the museum part of the center is going to have these wonderful artifacts from your administration.
Obviously, one of the things that makes history real for people is where when they can see the objects that were part of that history. Mm-hmm.
This right here, look at that baby face.
I can't believe that anybody would entrust somebody that young with anything, much less a seat in the U.S. Senate.
We stand here as one people, as one nation, proclaiming ourselves to be one America.
When I look at this young man in the picture, I think I'm glad that he was idealistic enough to think that he could actually pull it off.
Now, this certificate of marriage reminds me of the conversation that we had in 2012 at the White House.
Mr. President, are you still opposed to same-sex marriage?
It is important for me to go ahead and affirm that I think same-sex couples should be able to get married. One of the themes we hope of the Presidential Center is that all of us have a role to play in our neighborhoods, in our local communities. This, I think, is a wonderful symbol that quiet activism that happens every day to make our country better and the world better.
From the Senate to the White House and the journey along the way, former President Barack Obama cementing his legacy with the groundbreaking of his presidential center.
There will be at the top a credible room where people can look out over the Chicago landscape, and we'll have a branch of the Chicago Library here. We'll have classrooms and recording studios where young people can learn how to tell their stories.
Is it true that once upon a time you wanted to be an architect?
It is true. This is true. When I was a kid, and I'm fascinated with the architectural process and these little models and how these things get to put together.
The center, a blueprint for success. The vision crafted alongside the former First Lady. It's the Obamas' ambitious promise to uplift their South Side community.
We've set an extraordinarily high bar in terms of making sure that the people in these communities benefit. And we want to make sure that we're hiring people from the community, but we're also training them for a profession that over the long term they can build a life with and support a family with.
That pipeline includes Chicago Women in Trades, one of the organizations helping to build the center.
When we put out Chicago Women in Trades, it really resonates. It lets people know that this is the big city, and it is women that are building this city, rebuilding this city, and repairing this city.
Women like Zara Hill, a plumber, and Jennifer Ortiz, an iron welder, both lending a hand over the next 4 years.
This is history, and I'm a part of it. I'm a female Latina, you know, out there building Chicago.
It'll benefit my children, it'll benefit my grandchildren, it'll benefit my great-grandchildren to say that I had a hand, a little girl from Chicago, West Side, that threw her name in the hat.
The women committed to building a brighter future. So to recognize and celebrate their achievements, we wanted to give them a bit of a surprise.
There's just so many people want to say thank you to you, and I can't think of a better person to do that if you turn around right now.
Oh, no.
Excuse me. I had to come and say hi.
I've got to go. You're going to make me cry.
God. How are you?
How are you?
Good to see you.
I'm a hugger.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
How are you?
Oh, my God. Great.
I'm so excited.
So you get to the short one last.
Yes,
oh, my goodness. So nice. I'm so honored. Thank you.
Well, I am so excited that you guys are going to help build this world-class institution.
Yes. Thank you.
You guys ready?
Yes.
You ready to get to work? All right, let's do it.
President Obama paving a strong foundation and charting a new path forward for generations to come.
What's most important for your next act?
The thing that I figured out towards the tail end of my presidency is that you just don't have enough time to get everything done that you believe in. The single most important thing I can do is grab the next 1,000 or 10,000 or 100,000 or million Baracks and Michelles and maybe make the path just a little easier for them to make a difference. And if the center and the foundation that we put together is helping to plant that seed and empower a whole next generation of young leaders, that's a better and more important legacy to me than anything I got done by myself.
Our thanks to Robin and the former president. Finally tonight, the World War II veteran finally meeting his pen pal. Our Will Gans has the story.
12 years ago, a third grader wrote this letter to Frank Grassberger. Dear World War II veteran, if it wasn't for you, we would never have freedom. Your friend, Deshauna Priest. At the time, Frank and his wife, Dee, wrote a letter back to little Deshauna, not knowing if she ever got it. But Frank has kept his letter all this time.
I'm very proud of this.
Jill Pulowski wanted to do something special.
They said they had been looking for her, and it just, I don't know, it just popped in my head, like, maybe I can find her.
Jill tracking her down. Now 21 years old and only about an hour from where Frank and Dee live. Deshauna, who serves herself in the Army National Guard.
Oh, boy, I gotta hug you.
This is the girl, isn't it?
Yes.
Honest to God. Oh, I love you so much,
Jeff. We've looked for you
really
12 years.
Deshauna revealing she also kept the letter Frank sent to her all those years ago.
I feel so special.
Spending 2.5 hours getting to know one another.
Frank even said in his interview, like, she is like a third daughter to me.
The story of the 95-year-old veteran and the 21-year-old who wrote him a letter back in third grade, and the woman who brought them together.
God has been really good to me. Tell you the truth, I never thought I'd see you. I never.
I'm trying very hard to keep it together right now. What to you makes a person strong?
Keeping a positive attitude through everything that's thrown at you in life. And Frank even said, I couldn't leave this world without knowing where she was and that she was okay. And, you know, caring about someone who you don't even know, it's just crazy.
I cherish it. I really do.
Will, what a beautiful story and a perfect way to end our show tonight. Stay tuned to ABC News Live for more context and analysis of the day's top stories. I'm Phil Lipoff. Thanks for streaming with us.
guide you through it all tonight. We have made it through another week together.
Big hug, Richard.
We taught all our patients how much they are loved, to hold their hands.
David, we're showing our love and support for all the ICU staff.
They're the heroes in this.
It was an extraordinary story.
A computer salesman was supposed to report to prison to begin a 17-year sentence.
They let him turn himself into jail with no escort.
No one thought he would run.
How do you evade capture for 25 years? How do you do that?
Now, join the search, following the U.S. Marshals as they uncover new leads in a global manhunt. Can you help catch this fugitive?
Have you seen this man?
Have you seen this man?
Have you seen this man? Listen and join the all-new Hunt wherever you get your podcasts.
The world may feel out of your control, but your happiness doesn't have to be. Learn the secrets to happiness. Listen to the 10% Happier podcast, free on Apple Podcasts.
Now, with so much on the line, more Americans are turning to David Muir and ABC's World News Tonight than any other program across all of television.
This is GMA3, what you need to know.
GMA3.
A third hour of Good Morning America in the afternoon.
It's all about you. Lunchtime on ABC.
Now streaming on ABC News Live. 2020. True crime. Cinematic. Real life drama. Stunning. The unthinkable. Follow the clues. The hunt. True crime. 2020. Now streaming on ABC News Live. Most powerful stories of our time, anytime. Nightline.
You don't expect people to die in a flood.
Oh my God!
This is so big.
The water is so intense.
I'm Ginger Z, Chief Meteorologist at ABC News, and I want to welcome you to our ABC News Live Climate Special. It's called The Year of Extremes, and boy, has it been, even here in New York City. But we brought you here because that green building with the glass, that's the United Nations, founded on global cooperation, something that leaders that just met there say we are going to have and have urgently if we want to address the climate crisis. But we don't need a climate summit like the one coming up in Glasgow, which is important and called COP26, by the way. We just don't need it individually to know that we are living the change. Everything from the deepening drought to the erratic wildfires to the flash flooding that we saw here in New York City and even the rapid intensification of hurricanes. It's happening. Now, I understand climate change did not make natural disasters. They've always been with us. But human-induced climate change has magnified it. The science has been telling us for decades, and now we are living it. The question is, what are we going to do about it?
The UN issues its alarming new climate report, calling it a, quote, code red for humanity, warning the Earth is warming much faster than they thought.
Painting a dire picture of what the future may look like.
Unprecedented events are now becoming common, and scientists all point to one thing.
Unequivocally, humans are causing climate change, and some of our most extreme weather events have a link to that change.
Deaths rising from that historic heat wave in the Pacific Northwest.
Here on the street, this is measuring at 157 degrees. It feels like a furnace.
Drying up lakes and reservoirs that millions rely on for their water supply.
This time a year ago, this dock would have been about 30 feet underwater. It's now high and dry.
Madagascar, more than a million people facing starvation there.
It is all because they are in a prolonged drought. When you bake the soil, when you bake the foliage, you are creating the perfect setup for a horrible fire season.
The people who live in this community had to run for their lives as the flames came through and burned their homes and their cars. There are nearly 50 burning in six western states.
Thousands of people forced to evacuate and firefighters surrounded by flames as they wrestle with the Dixie Fire, destroying the entire town of Greenville.
All around, just complete destruction that goes on for blocks and blocks, completely unrecognizable.
A warmer planet means that we could have more extreme events.
July,
was the hottest month ever recorded.
The heat also fueling summer storms.
Elsa roaring ashore along the Gulf Coast.
Twister after twister zeroing in on Iowa.
Oh, look at that. Look.
Dangerous flash flood conditions in Nevada and Arizona.
Oh, my God.
Parts of western Germany, days of heavy rain wiping away entire communities.
There's so many people dead.
Flash floods in China killing at least 25 and displacing hundreds of thousands.
Forecasters warning more rain is on the way.
My island is on fire.
Apocalyptic fires raging across Greece as temperatures reach 113 degrees.
Siberia is normally one of the coldest places on the planet, but it's currently covered in wildfires. And for the first time in recorded history, smoke from those fires has even reached the North Pole.
In Turkey, flash floods caused by torrential rain, hundreds unaccounted for.
Torrential rain pounding southwest Japan.
Rescuers still searching for those missing after those devastating floods in Tennessee.
We were on the roof of our house.
Ida, one of the strongest hurricanes on record to hit Louisiana.
A dangerous Category 4 hurricane, winds 130 miles per hour.
Oh, that roof is coming. Holy
catastrophic storm surge up to 8 feet.
This is a storm we're going to be talking about through the midweek and unfortunately throughout history.
Where does this head next? This will be felt across several states as it now moves north.
Tropical storm Ida barreled through the northeast overnight.
Historic and deadly flooding.
NYPD officers braving a flooded basement in Queens, trying to rescue a family, including a toddler.
The walls of a New Jersey home caving in under pressure.
The cars are stuck and we have bodies underwater. We are now retrieving bodies.
Look at that tornado!
At least 7 confirmed tornadoes hitting the Philadelphia area and southern New Jersey.
We are in a whole new world now. Let's be blunt about it. The brutality of storms now, it is different.
Drought and wildfires are plaguing the western United States.
Firefighters battling out of control flames, desperate to keep the Caldor fire from taking over South Lake Tahoe.
I don't know how the conversation tonight, tomorrow, and beyond doesn't turn to how do we aggressively mitigate greenhouse gas emissions.
We can't undo the mistakes of the past. This generation can make the systemic changes that will stop the planet warming. And if we don't act, who will?
Kind of hard to believe that that all happened this year, and a lot of it in the last couple of months. But those events were not surprises to meteorologists, and they weren't to climate scientists either. They've been warning about this for decades. So we spoke to one of those scientists, who happens to be the senior advisor on climate for NASA, Gavin Schmidt. We not only talked about the science, but how you and me, even if we haven't lived one of those extremes yet, need to pay attention.
This is like 6 inches of rainfall within the last 3 hours.
Tornado!
I'm out of here.
We're seeing things happen and change that are clearly unprecedented in many millennia, and we have a good understanding of why. It's because of what we've been doing to the atmosphere, it's because of the burning of fossil fuels and the increases in greenhouse gases.
Everybody wants to say, yeah, what about the orbit? What about the sun? Sure. What about, and each one does have a part, just none so much or so closely paralleled with the increase in temperature as greenhouse gas emission.
We have no shortage of ideas for why climate might change. And over 4 billion years of Earth's history, the climate has changed for all of those reasons. And it turns out that the biggest thing is carbon dioxide and the other greenhouse gases.
There it goes! There goes another half of the roof! There goes there's the pole!
I recently covered Ida, and I was in New Jersey by a washed-out bridge.
Ginger is live in Demarest, New Jersey.
Cecilia, we would have had a storm without human-induced climate change. Of course, we've had storms forever, but behind me you see that road with the double yellow, the collapsed bridge, there were cars inside of it. You ask, how much have we amplified these storms? I related it to amplification by human-induced climate change. Now, scientists have called it global warming since the late 1800s.
I mean, our understanding of if we add carbon dioxide to the atmosphere, year the planet will warm mm-hmm. dates to the 19th century.
Right. Yeah.
Details have been filled in, the calculations have been improved, everything's much more sophisticated. But that answer that they knew in the 1800s is still true now.
There's not one part of us that's saying fires, floods, tornadoes, hurricanes are the result of climate change, that they are amplified by climate change.
Yeah, it's a really fascinating topic. We can see things happening in the global average, right? So we've been able to see the global mean changes decade by decade have been getting warmer mm-hmm. very, very clearly. Unequivocal warming of the planet. But for a long time, people said, well, that's not really going to impact the weather. It's not really going to impact the storms because there's so much noise, right? Mm-hmm. There's so much chaos and there's so much randomness. We're not going to be able to detect that. But the fact of the matter is that we can now detect the changes that the global mean change is having, global warming is actually having on specific weather events. Of course, heat waves. Heat waves are becoming more frequent and greater in magnitude than they were before, right?
So take me to the background and tell me, what does the future of storms look like? What does the future of drought look like?
We're seeing more intense and longer lasting heat waves. We're seeing more intense rainfall. So when it is raining, it's raining stronger. Mm-hmm. We're seeing more category 3, 4, 5 hurricanes in the Atlantic. That seems to be driven by the overall warming of the main development region, the tropical Atlantic. We're seeing that when there is drought, the droughts are more intense because there's more of an evaporative demand. So the soil is drying out faster given the same amount of rainfall change.
How do we make people care that don't have a sea level rising, how does this connect to people?
We have to talk to people where they are, what their issues are. You know, I mean, sea level is a much, much bigger deal in Florida, in Newport, and in Chesapeake Bay, and in Louisiana than it is in Nevada, obviously,
sure.
Right? And so things that are happening in the Arctic, the connection there to sea level is very, very real. You don't need to play games to explain that what happens a long, long way away is making a difference right here and now.
Gavin and I also spoke about the Arctic, warming at 3 times the rate than anywhere else on the planet. And I know you've probably abstractly heard about melting glaciers and then sea level rise, but maybe you don't know what it means to you. Well, James Longman went to the Arctic Circle, to Greenland, to help us understand. On top of that, the other thing that always comes up is China. So they make double the greenhouse gas emissions than we do in the US. We got to talk to somebody who has their ear, the climate czar for the White House, John Kerry.
All right, here we go. You ready? Let's do it.
Yes, it's the show America wants and America needs right now.
This is What Would You Do?
Let's go. How are you?
Can I hug you?
Yes.
So what will you be watching Saturdays on ABC News Live?
What would you do?
Hey, I guess I just found out.
The What Would You Do Marathon, 12 to 6 Eastern, every Saturday on ABC News Live.
My favorite show.
In one of the most remote places in the world, there is a disaster happening every minute of every hour of every day. Now, our James Longman went all the way to Greenland, to the Arctic Circle, to show us this silent catastrophe.
Greenland, the world's largest island, known for its vast tundra and mammoth glaciers. But this beautiful Arctic desert is retreating.
I'm standing right in front of the Russell Glacier here in Greenland, part of Greenland's melting ice sheet. And really what happens here is at the heart of the climate crisis.
We headed for this Arctic front line to camp out on the ice and link up with a group of scientists and locals to see this changing world up close.
This is Greenland's ice sheet. It makes up something like 85% of the whole of Greenland. Where we're standing, the ice is something like 60 meters thick. In some places, it's as thick as 2 miles.
Last Logstrop took me on a quad bike to the edge of the Russell Glacier. Life here is rugged, to say the least. He spent 20 years watching things change.
I'm a dog sledge owner, have my own dog sledge. When I was driving dog sledge here 20 years ago, it was for 7 months. Now it's only for 5 months because the season is getting lower, the summer is getting warmer, but also more rain is coming down and a lot of things are changing.
So you've lost 2 months of snow.
In 20 years?
Yes.
So if on that same trajectory, in the next 20 years, you could only have 3 months of snow left.
Yeah, we are fearing that.
The ice in the Arctic is crucial to regulate the temperatures of the world.
And it's not just an increase in temperatures that's causing them to melt.
This is one of the most extraordinary walks I've ever been on. Walking through Greenland's ice sheet. And it's absolutely stunning. The dark patches you can see, that is silt, that is ground down rock that's coming up from underneath the ice. Thousands of years old. But further in, there's something called black ice.
If you change the colour of the ice, then it's capable of absorbing almost all of the radiations. And it's becoming blacker because of the materials that we've been putting into the atmosphere. Some of that's natural through dust from the global deserts. Some of it's man-made directly, such as the pollutants from the burning of fossil fuels. The forest fires that we've seen across the world, including Siberia, liberate material onto the ice sheet.
Richard Washington is a professor of climate science at the University of Oxford, and he tells us to take note of one small but very important element of our day. It's raining, when really it should be snowing. Rain here is rare, and at the centre of the ice cap last month, rain was recorded for the first time ever.
What's it like for you being here, seeing all this?
Well, for 20 years, each of 20 years, I've been teaching about the Greenland ice sheet and its role in the climate system. And for the first time, here I am standing on it on a rainy day, would you believe, with the ice melt passing underneath us. So it's quite a moment.
What you're looking at here is just ice melt. That's water running off Greenland's ice sheet. There are only two ice sheets anywhere in the world, one in Antarctica and the other one here. And it's important that this happens because Greenland contributes 8% of the Earth's fresh water. What's not so good is that it happens so fast. The melt here is accelerating and it's contributing to the rise in global sea levels. So from London to New York, from New Orleans to Shanghai, what happens here in Greenland affects all of us.
The Arctic is the engine room of the climate system of the Earth. The Arctic is in the core, is the center, and controls much of the mechanisms that keep our climate system active.
Over the last 40 years, the speed of this ice retreat has astonished even the scientists we met. What lies ahead for this Arctic wilderness and around the world is unknown.
Research begins.
But for Carlos Duarte, professor of marine science at King Abdullah University in Saudi Arabia, it is not too late. He's studying ways to reverse and stop global climate change, and he says the signs of it are all around us.
We went up over the Russell Glacier to get a better look. These stunning turquoise melt lakes, a sign of deterioration on the ice sheet. The buildup of water creates these massive sinkholes.
If you are a scientist working on marine ecosystems, working on the biosphere and ecology, you need to face climate change.
The answer, he says, could be in the mud beneath the ice. Duarte says as the ice retreats, it leaves mud churned up from the billion-year-old rock below. That mud, he hopes, is chemically unique and can trap carbon. His proposal, transfer massive amounts of this special mud into the ocean to keep it from releasing more climate-warming carbon into the atmosphere.
It's almost like the Earth is giving you the medicine it needs. You just have to go and find it.
You have to go and find it.
While Duarte tries to heal the ice, those who call Greenland home hope the world is paying attention.
Do you feel like the world is listening to you?
They haven't for a long time, but I do sense that things are changing.
A need to be heard and an increasing call to take action before a critical international summit this fall.
I think we have a choice to make here. Do we want to allow the temperatures to continue increasing and have a very negative effect on, for example, agricultural production, on our health systems? Do we want to allow our children to walk into a broken planet, broken environment where they will not be able to thrive? or do we want to make the changes that are necessary in order to open possibilities that are much better for us? Because here's the thing that we have to remember. This is not about saving the planet. Frankly, the planet has been around for 4.5 billion years. And she started without us. She didn't ask us for any opinion, okay? She has been around and she will continue. If we are stupid enough to press the button on the ejector seat and make Earth uninhabitable for us, she will continue perfectly happily without us. This is not about saving the planet. This is about ensuring that the conditions, the environmental conditions that have made this planet habitable for us, that they actually continue. That is what this is about.
Wow. Thank you, James.
This wouldn't be a climate special unless somebody said, save the planet. But we really shouldn't be saving the planet. The planet's gonna be fine. We should be saving ourselves and life as we know it, or that we can live it comfortably. And that's why we wanted to talk about leadership, because we're gonna need it. And we spoke to the special presidential envoy for climate, John Kerry. He is someone who will have big stakes and tells us about them in that big summit coming up in Glasgow.
World will step up.
John Kerry, Vietnam War veteran, former presidential candidate, a U.S. senator for nearly two decades, then Secretary of State, and today he's President Biden's climate czar, taking on one of the biggest challenges of his career.
President Biden used the words, people need to bring their highest ambitions to COP26.
To keep within our reach the vital goal of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius, every nation needs to bring their highest possible ambitions to the table.
Ambition without action is fantasy. How do we go from fantasy and make sure that doesn't happen and get measured result from 2 weeks in Glasgow?
Glasgow's not the end of the road. Mm-hmm. It's the best opportunity we have. Why? Because this is the moment that the scientists told us. Mm-hmm. We have now about 9 years within which to make the most important decisions that get us there. This is the test, really, of the foundation of the United Nations, of the whole notion,
yes,
of community on an international basis, of countries helping other countries. President Xi of China made a very important announcement that China is no longer going to fund any coal-fired power plants externally, mm-hmm, outside their country. That sends a terrific message.
Sure.
And President Xi is to be congratulated for stepping up now. I hope China will do more.
Well, that's what, when I saw that announcement, you know, not investing abroad and helping develop green energy in other countries that are developing is wonderful. But what, how does that weigh out with dozens of new coal-fired power plants within China?
Well, they're still looking at that, I know. They're trying to examine what their peak level will be, mm-hmm, for emissions. They feel like they didn't have other alternatives, and they therefore grew the coal while they had to grow their economy. And my hope is that President Xi is going to help us all to come together around certain choices we can each make.
I think within the U.S., people feel more hope, but then their mind and words always go to China. And so they'll often ask me, and I say, I don't have a word with China, but you do, and you just came back again. Do you feel when you go there, there is good faith that things will actually happen? Because if you hear 2060, we're going to be carbon neutral by then,
yeah,
but then you see the investment in fossil fuel, it is very hard for me or anyone else to see that add up. Like, what are we missing?
I mean, it obviously, yeah, obviously, we all need to do faster. Every,
sure,
country has,
correct,
to go faster. None of us can say we're really fast. There are few countries, you can get them on one or two hands, that are in keeping with the Paris, mm-hmm, numbers. Most countries, we have a long way to go. But the 191 countries that have all put in their plans together, whether they've changed them, improved them, or have kept them the same, that 191 result in a 16% increase in emissions. Mm-hmm. That is a big F. That fails.
Right.
Fails for everybody. And we're going to keep negotiating, working with countries in order to try to bring them on board. And as you know better than anybody, because you're a trained meteorologist, mm-hmm, we are contributing to this.
Yes.
Human beings are,
no question,
responsible for,
yes,
this accelerated process of deterioration. Mm-hmm. And it will take us making basic choices to get us back on track. The good thing is We can do this.
I have a weekly segment. It's called It's Not Too Late, for that very reason, because I firmly believe it's not, and I know scientifically it's not.
You don't want people to wake up in the morning and say, I don't want to get out of bed, and they go home. And if you really sit and take in all of the potential negatives.
In the climate crisis.
Climate crisis, some people just freeze and say, I don't know what to do. That's bigger than me. I can't be individually responsible for that. Someone else is going to have to fix it, or some technology is going to roll along that's going to fix it. I hope so. But in the absence of that, you've got to apply the precautionary principle of living and of governing.
There are benchmarks, as you said, 9 years, 1.5. Why not be more aggressive then than 1.5? Because it's just not realistic?
You've got to be realistic where the science can let you go here. We're not doing this because Joe Biden has a philosophy.
Right.
Or because, although his philosophy helps him to do it, but it's not because of that. It's not ideology. It's not politics. It doesn't have a label. It's science.
Mm-hmm. It's being billed as the best last chance to curb greenhouse gas emissions. But then the UN Secretary General says, hey, if we don't all come together and urgently, collectively make this change, there's a high risk of failure. So to you, what's the best outcome and what's the worst?
Well, the best outcome is that the 20 largest economies of the world will come together recognizing that they are responsible for 80% of all the emissions. Mm-hmm. So there is a special responsibility on the developed world. And if the developed world will step up, I have no question but that the rest of the world will be able to follow and to make choices that they can't otherwise make today. So we have to help them do that.
There will have to be financial help for the developing country. That's the part that really hasn't been followed through from Paris, is the money hasn't showed up.
Correct, except that President Biden took a huge step towards that. By committing to double the amount that already had been doubled in order to show good faith to help leverage the production of the 100 billion from the whole world that needs to be made available to countries to make this happen.
Going back to those UN numbers with the 2.7 degrees expected by the end of the century, I think Greta Thunberg says, this is what betrayal looks like. Whatever our so-called leaders are doing, they're doing it wrong. And it made us think about that. It is a beautiful image of you signing the Paris Agreement with your granddaughter Isabel on your lap, and that's just 5 years ago or so. Do you think that as a globe, the leaders have failed, Isabel, and her generation?
A lot of them have failed, but I think it's unfair. I think it's a little much of a reach to say that so-called leaders, there are a lot of real leaders around, and they are trying very, very hard to move this process. And I understand Greta's frustration and anger, which is, I feel the anger, same anger. Mm-hmm. People are getting in the way, some people. And what we need to do is behave like adults and get the job done. And she's absolutely right to be pressing the urgency of our doing that. But there are leaders out there trying to get some things done, just too slowly in some cases. And we've got to speed it up.
I'm looking forward to COP. I hope I get to be there for part of it.
Well, I hope you're there, and we look forward to seeing you.
You as well. Thank you. The world's leaders certainly have a huge job ahead of them in Glasgow. But that doesn't take the onus off of us. We have agency and responsibility. So what can we do to help? Well, we can vote for those leaders. We can vote with our dollar and just change things. Everything from our fashion to what we're eating to what we're driving. There are alternatives out there, and they're not sacrifices. In a lot of cases, they're upgrades. We just need to find equity in these alternatives. And once we do that, it really isn't too late. Thanks so much for joining us for the Year of Extremes. I'm Ginger Z. We'll see you in Glasgow.
guide you through it all tonight.